Actually, I may be in the wrong room because the speech I prepared tonight is titled Quantum Mechanics Synchronized with Electromagnetic Spectrum as Anticipated by the Theory of Relativity. Instead, you have me talking about the Men in Black, huh? See, already you're not taking me seriously. The Men in Black really are not anything new. Can you hear me in the back? Because I may fade away here. There are many references in the Bible which could be interpreted as Men in Black type incidents, because they, although they're called angels, they're usually were in threes, as our modern Men in Black are. They travel in threes, and they got into all sorts of mischief. You remember the three men who went to Sodom and Gomorrah and warned the innocent people, the few innocent people there. Today that would be interpreted as a Men in Black incident, because a Men in Black is a generic term. It doesn't cover just the Men in Black and black Cadillacs who arrive at the scene of UFO incidents. As I'll describe to you later, there are all kinds of Men in Black. They're mystery men, and we don't know who they are, where they come from, or who's supporting them. And some of these people apparently have a lot of logistical support and financial support that's very mysterious. In the Orient, for thousands of years, they've had a legend called the King of the World. And it's surprising how many people believe in this. And in the 20s and the 30s, various explorers who were traveling through the Himalayas and India and Mongolia, Outer Mongolia, they all heard these legends, and there were a lot of books in the 20s and 30s that mentioned the King of the World. He's right behind me now, rewinding. The King of the World supposedly lives in an underground city. Now, we've all heard about underground cities. Well, somewhere in the reaches of Outer Mongolia, there's supposed to be an underground city where the King of the World resides, and he sends out his agents to control the world, the surface world, and these agents are Men in Black. They're Orientals, they look Oriental, they're dressed in black garments, and they supposedly travel all over the world. And these legends are very extensive, and they've been going on for a long time. So half the world believes that the Men in Black are from the underground, from the Agartha, you've heard that name probably. There have been various books on it. And as I say, in the 20s and 30s, a lot of books. In the 1940s, a man named Richard Shaver sort of revived it and gave it an American twist with his Shaver mystery, which was about underground cities populated by detrimental robots, or Duros, who controlled everything on the surface with their mysterious rays. And the Shaver mystery, today it's almost forgotten, but it dominated the UFO field for the first 5 or 6 years. From 1947 to 1955, the Shaver mystery was the number one explanation for everything that was going on. Ray Palmer published quite a few books, supposedly written by Shaver, but as it turns out, they were really written by Ray Palmer, promoting this idea, and promoting the Shaver notions of Men in Black, because there were a lot of Men in Black stories in the Shaver mystery. And there, until just recently, there was a magazine out west called The Shavertron, which was about the Shaver mystery. And there's another magazine called The Hollow Hassle, which was about the Hollow Earth, where all of these Men in Black were coming from, supposedly. But then, if you go to other religions, the Western religions, you find all kinds of Men in Black stories, especially in the Catholicism and in the Protestant religions. We have all the stories about the devil, who very often is described as looking Oriental, very sinister looking Oriental, dressed in black garments. And so It has deep roots, this whole concept of the men in black, in witchcraft, which is a booming religion right now, even though most of you aren't aware of it. There are two stores in New York City that just sell equipment for witchcraft. During the rituals that some witches indulge in, they have one of the number dress up in black, and they act out the role of the man in black. And this is a part of the witchcraft religion. In the late 1940s, there was a famous World War II general named Karl Spatz, who was the general in charge of the Air Force in Europe for part of the war. And he made a very strange statement around 1948-49. He said there was absolutely, this was at a press conference, he said there was absolutely no evidence that flying saucers were piloted by Spaniards. And this was really from left field. Apparently people had been informing the Air Force that they'd seen a flying saucer and a Spaniard got out of it. Meaning that he was a olive-skinned person with who looked like a Spaniard. We never got the Air Force material that Spatz based that comment on, but it was a very peculiar statement. When I was traveling extensively around the country, I used to carry a lot of photographs with me in my briefcase, photographs of different kinds of objects, and also photographs of different ethnic groups, because I was running into men in black witnesses all over the country. And I would go through these photographs with them to ask them if they saw anyone that resembled the man in black that they had seen. There were photographs of Indians, there were photographs of the various Negroid races from Africa, there were photographs of Eskimos. There was a little mix of all kinds of ethnic groups. And there was one photograph that everybody jumped on. They would stop and say, that is looks just like the guy that I saw. And believe it or not, it was a photograph of a Laplander from northern Sweden. Now, they have a kind of oriental look to them. They're small in stature, and they have a distinctive look. And so, I'm not saying that the men in black are all Laplanders, but they certainly look like them and seem to be related to them. Now, we have the legends that everyone will see a man in black sooner or later. And the legend, which is an old legend, says you will see the man in black three times. And the third time you see him, it means you're going to die. And if you go through the history books, you'll find that a lot of people have reported this, including Maria Antoinette, and people that you wouldn't expect to have this kind of involvement, Napoleon. So that legend is a continuing legend and a strong one. The other kind of man in black that we have, and that I've seen myself, we, for the want of a name, we call them the cadavers. Now, these are people who look like they've been dead a long time. And their clothes hang on them. Their flesh is pasty white. And they look like maybe somebody had dug them up from a cemetery last week, and they're walking around. And this cadaverous type has turned up in strange places, in England, in Sweden. Brad Steiger saw one. As I say, I saw one in the early 60s. And we have no idea what these fellows are about. They're very elusive. When you approach them, they sort of hurry away. I've never heard of them saying anything to anybody. But they do have a habit of turning up in UFO areas and following UFO investigators around. So if you ever see a cadaverous-looking man out there following you, you'll know who he is. He's one of them. Now, we have a lot of mystery men in this country that we've never been able to explain. Mystery men who turn up at UFO sightings and spread all kinds of false material around. There was a well, one that comes immediately to mind happened in Texas a few years ago. There was a big movement to dig up a grave in Texas where a little man was supposedly buried. And one, a very well-dressed businessman type, came to this cemetery, and he handed out his business card, and he spent hours there, and he got everybody all stirred up, and he left. And it turned out that his business card was a fraud, and the name that he gave everybody was a fraud. And we don't know where he came from, or where he went, or why he bothered to go to this cemetery. The story was that in 1896, a UFO had crashed in this little town in Texas, and there had been a little man aboard, and the people had buried him in the local cemetery. Now, this story, it turned out, was a newspaper hoax, as a lot of the stories from 1896 were. But somebody dug up this clipping in the 1970s, and there was a stampede to go to Texas, to this little town, and dig up the cemetery. Of course, the local people didn't like that very much, and it was all a big sensational brouhaha. Nobody ever found anything in the cemetery, but it was great fun for a while. And we have a lot of that type of incident, where somebody deliberately stirs up the UFO buffs, and then they vanish, and the UFO buffs remain stirred up sometimes for months or many months afterwards. And very often the stories of these strange, bogus people circulate, get into the UFO literature, and become part of the UFO literature. During the Vietnamese War, in those days, and I'm talking now about the 60s, I had a network of informants all over the country who were sending me newspaper clippings for a newsletter that I was publishing. And I started getting these little clippings from random places, far-flung places, Minnesota and New Mexico and Oregon. And it was the damnedest thing. Somebody was visiting the families of men who were in Vietnam. And this somebody was dressed in a military uniform. And they would drive up to the house of the family. And they would follow military procedures exactly. They would inform the mother or the wife or the father or brother, whoever, that their relative had been killed in Vietnam. And this was a very sinister thing, because it would turn out to be untrue, but you can imagine what it would do to the family for a few days until they found out that it was not true. And these fellows, whoever they were dressed in the proper military uniform. Our men in black, by the way, when they're in military uniform, there's always something wrong with it. There's something askew. But these men were dressed in proper military uniforms, and they were driving the proper vehicles. Now, anyone who's been in the Army knows that military officers don't ride around in black Cadillacs. They ride around in sedans, Chevys and Fords and things that are usually painted brown. And that's the way these men, what they would be driving would be a simple car, a sedan that's been painted brown. And as I kept getting these clippings, because if we got a few clippings about this, it probably was happening in a lot more places. I assumed that sooner or later the FBI or some police department would do something and we'd have a big story out of it. But it never happened. These stories trickled in for maybe 2 or 3 years. And whoever these crazy people were, they were doing a lot of damage to these families. You also have to realize that they had to know about the boy in Vietnam, what unit he was stationed with and everything, and they also had to know where his family was located. Some of these families were located on isolated farms that would be pretty hard to find, and yet these guys would drive up to the farm and talk to the mother or the relative, and as I say, tell them that the boy had been killed. So they had to have some kind of elaborate support, a connection with the military in order to do that kind of thing. And it didn't seem, there was a lot of anti-war sympathy, of course, at that time, but it didn't seem to be an action of one of those anti-war groups. So, for want of a better name, we would call these people Men in Black. And they may still be out there, but who knows what they're doing now. When I first got into the UFO thing in the 1960s in a big way, it was a popular belief that men in Air Force uniforms were silencing witnesses. And this belief was spread by APRO and NICAP because they would keep getting reports that a man in an Air Force uniform would arrive at the home of the witness and tell him to shut up and keep quiet, appeal to their patriotism. Well, we had a rash of these things on Long Island, and I had strong connections in the Pentagon at that time. An old Army buddy of mine was an assistant to the Secretary of the Air Force. And these Air Force officers would give a name, sometimes they'd show credentials. They would always be in a black Cadillac, which, as I say, is not standard procedure for a military officer. Usually somebody else would be driving the Cadillac. And these men would be in military uniform, but there would be something just a little bit wrong. The insignia would be in the wrong place on the jacket. Or they would be wearing the wrong type of shoes. To see a military officer dressed in a dress uniform and wearing sneakers, kind of strange. And there was always something that the witness would remember. He said, hey, that was funny. Well, one woman in Wisconsin told me that she invited the officer in and offered him some Jell-O, and he tried to drink the Jell-O. And so it didn't take me long to figure out that maybe these guys really weren't Air Force officers. And my contacts in the Pentagon could not locate these people, the names that they were being given. And when we checked out, in a few cases we had the license numbers of the cars, and we would check those out, which is very easy to do, and we'd find out the license had never been issued to anybody. So now how in the world, if you were going to make up a phony license plate, what kind of luck would it take for you to come up with a number that nobody else had? So I started antagonizing the UFO bus by saying, these guys are not from the Air Force. And he said, Keel is obviously working for the CIA. But as soon as I got wise to them, they started using other techniques. They always stayed one step ahead of me. We had a variety of strange incidents that happened over and over again, and never made any sense at all. One of my favorites is the phantom meter reader. This is where a man would knock at a door of a house in the suburbs and say he'd come to read the meter, the electric meter and the gas meter. And he would be dressed in the proper coveralls and all, and they would let him in. He'd go down into the basement, and he wouldn't come out. And these people, after about an hour, they said, what the hell is he doing down in my basement? And they would look, and sometimes the man would be gone, altogether, never to be seen again, and even though there was no way out of that basement. And other times, the man would be just starting up the stairs as they opened the cellar door to find out where he was. So the phantom meter readers was one type of MIB that we've had. Then we had the phantom photographers, and these were humdingers. Because these fellows turned up everywhere, and they often traveled in pairs. One would be a woman, and the other would be a man. And they were usually quite well-dressed, and they usually would arrive in a black Cadillac until I started doing articles about the black Cadillacs, and then they switched to Volkswagens. And they were driving around West Virginia in their Volkswagens, and they would drive up to the house of a witness, a UFO witness, who just had a baby, and they would say that they were photographers, professional photographers, and they wanted to photograph the baby. And of course, new parents would be delighted to have that done. So they would set up their equipment, and they'd take pictures of the baby, and they'd give the people a card with a neighboring town listed on the card as the, you know, Acme photographers. And they would drive away. And it would turn out that there was no such thing as Acme photographers, and they would never come back. And if they were professional photographers, they'd never tried to sell the photographs to these families. So that was another mystery. And then we had the phantom photographers who, after somebody, say you'd never seen a UFO before in your life, and then one night you're out driving home late, and you see a UFO close up. and you live in the suburbs. The next day, you're getting up, it's say 9 o'clock in the morning. For me, it would be 12 or 1 o'clock in the afternoon. You're getting up, and there's a Cadillac parked in front of your house, and some men get out, and they take out a big tripod and a big heavy camera, and they set it on the tripod, and they take a picture of your house. And then they put it all back in the car, and they drive away. You figure they're going to come up to the door and offer to sell you a picture of your beautiful house. But they don't do that. They just get in the car and drive off. In the course of my investigations, I learned to ask people about, not just about what they had seen, but about any strange thing that had happened to them around the time of their sighting, that week or even that month. And a lot of people would come up with some very strange things, very strange visitors. And we still get reports of these strange visitors. About 10 years ago in New York City, there was a lady in black that used to hang around the pickup bars around 2nd Avenue. And this woman became a legend in New York. I know some of you may have heard of her. But she would approach men in the bar and get them all excited. And then she would excuse herself and go into the ladies' room and never come out again. There must have been 100 of these stories during that period. She was supposedly a very good-looking lady, too, dressed in a very slinky black dress. And God knows what game that was, or what the purpose of all that was for. Now, as I said, we've had an opportunity. A lot of witnesses have either offered them food or seen these people in restaurants, and we've had an opportunity to see their eating habits, which are disgusting. These people do not know how to eat. They, as I said, one of them tried to drink Jell-O. They don't know how to handle a knife and fork. In one incident, the waitress had to come over and show the man how to cut a steak. And then they didn't chew their food. They just sort of swallow it, gulp it down. And they figure they're getting away with it, but everybody in the place is watching them do it. And again, they always look like Orientals who are not quite Oriental. Again, the Laplander kind of look. And they're always dressed in black clothes, which most often is out of style. They're wearing something that would have been in style in 1946 instead of 1986. And so there's always some little thing that's out of whack with these people, just as the military officers wear sneakers, as I said. Now, we have a lot of things lumped into the same category. There are various incidents that I was involved in over the years. We had a UFO investigator in Maine who was, people, and some of you probably know all about this, get very obsessed with UFOs. It dominates their whole life, and especially if they become UFO investigators in a small town. It takes over their life. And then they become very credulous, and all sorts of strange things can seem to happen to them. We had a UFO investigator in Maine who was driving around an area where UFOs had been seen, and he saw a black Cadillac. And he had a gun with him, and he got out of the car and started shooting at the black Cadillac, which really upset the guy who was driving the black Cadillac, because it wasn't a black Cadillac at all. This UFO investigator was hallucinating. He thought he was seeing a black Cadillac, and it was an ordinary car, and being driven by an ordinary person. And it was almost a very serious incident. The investigator was hauled into jail, and nobody would believe his story, and he turned to me thinking I could get him out of the slammer. But what am I going to go up there and say, listen, the man is shooting at black Cadillacs, and he thinks he sees men in black. We had a UFO investigator in Massachusetts who was seeing alligators. Now this poor man, would turn on the spigot in his bathroom, and an alligator would come out of the faucet. He would get into his car and he'd look in the back seat, and there's an alligator in the back seat. So he was hallucinating about alligators. And I knew there was nothing much. He was writing me these long letters telling me about all the alligators he was seeing. And I sent a friend of mine, Dr. Berthold Schwartz, up to see him. And when Dr. Schwartz arrived there, the man had a shotgun by the door, and he was waiting for Dr. Schwartz, but he was afraid that Dr. Schwartz was a man in black. Dr. Schwartz is a famous psychiatrist. But we do have a lot of, I can't really call them screwballs, because there's something more involved here. It's where their minds just get carried away with the whole UFO thing. The term that I used to use was a distortions of reality. So that very often the people that you're seeing may not be men in black at all. They may be just an ordinary guy in an ordinary suit, and your mind is making him a man in black. Betty and Barney Hill, I don't know if you're up enough with the literature, but Betty and Barney Hill had quite a few men in black episodes, which may have been just hallucinatory. They would go into a restaurant, and they would be followed by this man in a black suit with a mustache, and he would sit down at the table next to them, and while they're eating, this man in black is eating soup, and his mustache falls in his soup. And it was obvious that these people were just following Betty and Barney Hill around, and we would put them into the men in black category. We do know that in the early 1950s, the CIA was directly involved in UFO investigations. But after 1952, there's no really hard evidence of it. The CIA has confessed to the fact that they were involved in UFO investigations between 48 and 52. But then in 52, they had the famous Robertson panel, which decided on the UFO policy. And after that, the CIA was supposedly out of it. But there were still a lot of cases that smelled of the CIA. When those of you who remember, I guess most of you do, Lee Harvey Oswald, when Lee Harvey Oswald was arrested, a large group of men in black suits went to the base in Japan where he had been stationed at one point, and they searched the whole place. This is with all the military officers standing by. And this is in the books about Lee Harvey Oswald. So we do have agents who are so smart that they wear black suits all the time and wrap around sunglasses and do really stupid things so that they'll stand out. It would seem to me that if they wanted to be really smart, they would dress in dungarees and have long hair and carry a guitar. But no, they have to dress in their uniform, just as the FBI agents are always in uniform. They look like clones. They all have the same haircut. They all have the same kind of clothing. Of course, J. Edgar Hoover was very strict. They had to look like FBI agents. Now, I had a friend in England. His name was Ted Holliday. He wrote a number of very good books. You may have remembered Ted Holliday. He saw a man in black at Loch Ness. Now, he had been spending every summer at Loch Ness. Looking for the famous sea serpent there. He did see the sea serpent once, or he thought he did. Anyway, he said this man in black was dressed in black leather with goggles and a helmet like a motorcyclist. And Ted walked up to him and turned his eyes away for about 10 seconds. And in that time, the man vanished. Now, 1 year later, Ted was on that same spot, because he went back there every year, and he had a severe heart attack. And as he was lying on a stretcher and they were about to carry him off from that spot, he realized that it was the exact spot where he had seen this man in black a year earlier. Now, Colin Wilson, the very famous British author, had a few comments to make on this said Holiday was experiencing a problem that is familiar to students of the paranormal. They begin more or less as open-minded skeptics, prepared to give serious consideration to any evidence that presents itself, but determined not to indulge in any self-deceptions. Finally, the sheer weight of the evidence convinces them that something odd is going on, and they try to create what Aldous Huxley called a minimum working hypothesis, an explanation that covers the basic facts. This may be, for example, telepathy. A famous writer named Lethbridge saw a ghost, a man dressed in a writing clothing, in the rooms of a university friend. And he theorized that someone else may have been thinking about this man, and that his own mind somehow picked up the image, like a television picture, without the sound. But he was forced to drop this explanation as he encountered other examples of the paranormal. And this tends to be the experience of the most serious investigators. Whenever they have formulated a watertight general theory, they stumble upon some new fact that simply refuses to fit in. And then they have to extend the theory. Then they find still more awkward facts, and they have to extend it still further. And in no time at all, their original, neat, symmetrical theory looks like an old sack stuffed with rubbish. Years ago, when we had a lot of magazines that we don't have anymore, general magazines, that carried a lot of articles, not only about UFOs, but about everything that was going on. Now it's very rare that we get any real in-depth investigative reporting anywhere. There was a magazine called Saga that used to do a lot of this, and I used to write for them. A lot of people wrote for them. A lot of the UFO writers wrote for Saga. And they, once they started carrying UFO articles, they started getting all kinds of hoax letters. And we knew they were hoaxes because they were perfectly typed, with no misspellings. And this was rare. You get an average letter from an average person, and there's always, you know, it's sloppy. But these things were perfectly done and beautifully typed. Obviously, somebody had the best of IBM typewriters at that time, and these things were well thought out and carefully done. And that's how we would know they were hoaxes. If we got a letter written in pencil and making all kinds of weird, exaggerated claims, we'd know that maybe was authentic. But these hoax letters were something else. We got one MIB account that the editor was quite excited about. And it was so well written that I pointed out it had to have been written by a professional writer. There's no way that the average witness could have written this. It was beautifully done, and he followed all of the rules of writing, which most people aren't even aware exist. And then he went into detail about this elaborate MIB experience, and then he followed it up with a postcard saying that he was leaving by a bus for an unknown destination so that we could never follow through and find out who he was. We've had around the world, we've had what they call the UMO letters. How many of you have heard of UMO? There have been books about it. This has been going on for over 20 years. It's about 25 years now, I think. These are very elaborate letters written in all languages and sent to leading researchers around the world. And these letters are filled with interesting philosophies. Whoever writes these things has a good knowledge of science and philosophy. Some of the letters are quite impressive. There are just too many of them. And everyone has a different postmark. One man in Spain may get a letter postmarked New Zealand, and the next UMO letter may turn up in Germany, written in German, and postmarked Canada. So whoever's mailing these things is mailing them from all over the world, and they're writing them in vast quantities. Who's ever doing it is doing it full time, which is a puzzle. And as I say, there are now a couple of books. I don't know if any of them have been translated into English, but books of these letters have been published in Europe. And at one point, the French government got involved in this. And the French government became convinced that they were in touch with another planet. And I'm talking about high up in the French government, the minister of France, the leading scientists of France were all involved, And then it turned into a great embarrassment because then hoaxes were pulled on them. And it was one of the sensational things of the 1970s. The result was that the French government gave up on UFOs, and they decided instead to fund the private investigators, the civilian investigators. And they gave them enough money to go out and investigate things, which is remarkable in any country. And these French investigators all became anti-UFO. Now that they had the funding and they were able to travel around, they reopened old cases like the famous, you may know that in 1952 there were a lot of UFO landings in France, all over France. They reopened a lot of these cases and they decided that they were all hoaxes. And it was a very strange turnabout. And it all started with the UMO letters to the top officials of France. Now, it is quite possible, it's even probable, that people high up in the American government have also been sucked into these kind of games and given up at some point. Now, it's 10 o'clock. How long am I supposed to go? 10 more minutes? Maybe I should take some questions. Yeah. Oh, that's a whole other big subject. I couldn't even start to talk about that.
And do you think these men in black have anything to do with the Illuminati?
Well, we don't know if the Illuminati really exists. It's one of those great, strong legends throughout history. You know, Robert Anton Wilson has written a lot of books about the Illuminati and elaborated on it. But it would take me another 2 hours to talk about the Illuminati. I personally don't think they exist, but there are a lot of people who do think they exist and that they're the cause of all our troubles. This would be a group of men who are illuminated and who control everything on this planet. The gentleman back there?
Are you familiar with the Mothman?
Yeah. The what? Approach me? No, but I've approached them. I've chased them. I've missed them by 10 minutes. When I was in West Virginia and Ohio, people would call me up at my hotel and they'd say, "Hey, these guys are here, and come and get them." And so I'd race there, and they'd be gone by 10 minutes. And we had the local police in a lot of towns looking for them. We had at one time, I had hopes that we would catch one of these fellows and solve a part of that mystery. Somebody asked me about Maury Island?
Yes, I did.
Uh-huh.
Maury Island,
that was considered the first Men in Black case.
Right.
And it turned out that's a very involved thing because I spent a lot of time on that Maury Island case. This is where a group of men were on a boat in Tacoma Harbor and they saw a couple of objects fly over the boat. This is in 1947. And early the next morning, a black car pulled up in front of the home of one of the witnesses, and a man got out and invited the witness to breakfast. And over breakfast, he warned him not to talk about what he had seen the day before. This was before he told anybody. So this became one of our first Men in Black cases. But when you really dig into that, it seems to have an explanation. At that time, that area, the Hanford Works is very close to that, where we make atom bombs. And there was a big thing going on with the spies, and later, of course, we had sensational spy trials about the atom bomb, where 65 of the scientists who were making the atom bomb were proved to be traitors, and they had been giving the Soviet Union materials. And this was all tied in with that. And so a lot of the stuff that was going on in Maury Island that didn't make sense at that time later makes sense in the context of the spy chases that were going on and all. And the original story where these objects were flying over Tacoma Harbor, this story has a certain flaws to it, namely that one of the men who made the most noise about it proved to be a tremendous liar. And it's a very involved and complex case. I have enough material to do a book on it, and nobody wanted to do the book. He said, "It's 1947, forget about it." Yeah. But But it was not one of our true Men in Black cases, I know. Yes. Well, no. The only photograph is Tim Beckley and his friends took a photograph some years ago in New Jersey. There was a black Cadillac that parked across from the home of a UFO investigator, and this man would get out of the black Cadillac and stand around and look at the house. And Jim Mosley and Tim Beckley and some others, maybe they'll tell you about it later, they went out there with cameras and they went chasing after this Cadillac. My theory is that it was somebody's chauffeur. And yeah. Well, there are a couple of cases where they seem to be machine-like. Like they run down like a clock. They'll talk with a witness for half an hour and they just run down. And then they'll leave the house and say the witness lives way out in the country somewhere. And they leave the house and they disappear, and the witness looks out the window and there's no car out there, nothing for them, no transportation for them. They just walk down the road. Another thing that happens in more than one case is it can be raining and miserable, and these people will arrive at the door and they're dry and their feet aren't muddy or anything. And yes, sir.
How much Men in Black
Not much, but we'll start hearing some stuff now.
Do you think there's a lot of exchange on UFO studies between our government?
No, but I think the Russians are way ahead of us in it. The Russians have, in the last couple of years, have had some big UFO conventions, and the speeches and the papers that they've delivered show that they've been paying attention to it for a long time. And while American ufologists have been bogged down with Roswell and MJ-12 and all that stuff, the Russians have really been studying the UFOs themselves, and they have a lot of interesting ideas. And now that everything is opened up, we're going to learn a lot from them, I think. Yes?
Do you have any information on deaths involved in the Men in Black?
We've had a lot of cases where they've threatened people, there are cases where they have bragged about killing people. There was a famous case where they bragged about killing Barney Hill, bragged to a doctor about that. But we don't have any direct evidence that that's happened. But there have been a lot of mysterious deaths in the UFO field. And from now on, you can watch for this. A lot of the leading UFO investigators have died on June 24th. In fact, even Jackie Gleason, who was a big UFO buff, he built a house up in the Catskills that looked like a UFO. When you drove by it, you'd swear a UFO had landed, and it was Jackie Gleason's home. But he died on June 24th, 2 years ago. But there are many others who died. Frank Edwards, who's you've all read his books probably, Frank Edwards died on June 23rd. Of course, June 24th is the date that Kenneth Arnold saw the sightings in 1947. Well, thank you very much. I think...
Chris Cooperrider is pregnant and needs a snowmobile ride to nearby Interstate 75. From there, she can be transported to the hospital in Bowling Green.
So my husband went over and asked the neighbor to radio for help, that anyone that had a sled, you know, if they could bring it out. Right after that, he comes back over and this guy comes up. He was dressed all in black snowmobile, and he had a black sled on the back. So he got us all bundled in and everything was fine. And we went to Signet, and Signet had an ambulance waiting for us. So they were trying to get me in the ambulance, and I'm all worried because I had taken a quilt, and I wanted to make sure I had this quilt. And so I'm getting the quilt in the ambulance, and all of a sudden we decide we need to thank this guy that got us there, and he was gone. And so we asked the emergency squad to thank him when they saw him again, and they go, "We thought you knew him." And we're going, "No, we thought he was part of the emergency squad because he came right after we radioed." And they said, "Oh, well, it must be somebody that heard your CB announcement that you needed help and showed up." Well, later on, my husband had gone to the neighbors to thank him for radioing, and the neighbor said, "I couldn't get the CB radio to work." So we still have no clue who this guy in black was. But the emergency squad didn't seem to know either, so it was kind of a mystery.